Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to Bethel Sunday Live. Always glad to have you here. I pray that you are doing well, that your family members are doing well. I pray that you're taking care of yourself, that you are practicing social distancing as much as possible, particularly those of us who are of more vulnerable populations, but really everyone, even if you're the healthiest person, in your community of acquaintances, you need to protect others around you. So that means that you have to keep yourself healthy. So practice social distancing, sanitize your hands as often as you can and need to, and just practice all of those hygienic tips that we've been given by health officials to keep us from getting the COVID virus. Again, welcome to this session of Sunday Live. We are looking forward to changes in the next few months as our state transitions into later phases to get us back circulating amongst each other. But while we are where we are, we're going to make the best of it. And so we're going to praise and worship the Lord in this way. Wherever you're watching us from, whether it's from work, you're on the road, you're at home, this is a time of worship and of praise, and so we want you to rein your minds in. I think it becomes more distracting when we're at home because different things are happening around us, so we have to discipline ourselves to focus. I won't take a lot of your time today, but I do want to share a word with you. There are announcements that are scrolling by above my right shoulder. For those of you who are joining us on teleconference, I think that particular audience, you kind of know where to go for the different services because you're there now. through the teleconference. And so we encourage you to keep participating and supporting in this way. We did announce to our congregation yesterday in our general church meeting that we are going to start to live stream from the church here pretty soon in the next few weeks. We're just waiting for some supplies to come before we pull that trigger. Again, this will not be regular church service, so don't try to come to Bethel to come to church. It's not going to work that way. But instead of doing these live streaming sessions from my home, we'll be doing them from the sanctuary so that we can add more components to the service. We'll have music, and we'll be doing acknowledgments of birthdays and other special occasions. We'll have others reading scripture, leading us in prayer, and also bringing us the gospel message. So I personally look forward to that because I miss those parts of the service. It'll be an abbreviated service, so it won't be what we were having prior to the quarantine, but there will be more for us to experience as a body. And for those who are able to participate, they will rotate participation in those services. So we look forward to that. Lord willing, we will be making those announcements soon. For the Bethelites who wish to help us in those live streams, those are the people who will be coming to the church on those days. For those of you who are going to help us with the live stream, you're going to make announcements, you're going to read scripture, you're going to lead in prayer, help Sister Borden. She'll need an assistant to help her with a couple of things. If you're willing to do that, as we stated yesterday, please call the church. Speak slowly, speak clearly. Leave a cell number and, as appropriate, leave an email address so that when we develop the schedule and we have the timeline, we can reach out to you. Again, we are asking those of you who are not part of vulnerable populations. You don't have asthma. You don't have bronchitis. You don't have a depressed immune system. By the way, age brings on a depressed immune system. So those of us who are older probably should just remain in our quarantine states for the time being, until there are therapeutics to help treat this virus and other things that will make us socializing a safer prospect, okay? So those of you calling the church to participate, again, you have asthma, bronchitis, let's not do that right now, all right? But if those things aren't true of you, we do invite you to help us in those services. Keep supporting your Sunday school class with Deacon Smith from the Bethel Church and with Elder Boyd from the Bethlehem Church. Keep supporting that. Keep supporting your midweek Bible studies, your midweek prayer services. Keep supporting your church financially, giving through Zelle and Venmo, using the church email addresses as a guide for that. And just let's keep connected. Let's keep connected. We are family. Let's keep connected. I also encouraged our members yesterday, you know, call each other. You have friends in the church. You have their numbers. You've talked to them before. Maybe it's been a long time. There are some people who are more isolated than others. They live by themselves, and so they're not getting that socialization that they typically would have gotten before the quarantine. Call them. Check on them. Express your concern. Express your love. Hold a social conversation. Ask them how they're doing. Share with them how your day is going. Give them that touch that we all need, that human touch that we all need. That too is ministry. Christ's most powerful times in ministry came when he was just reaching out to other lives. He wasn't necessarily teaching or preaching. He was just reaching out to other lives. The paralytic who we'll talk about today, the blind, those with palsy. You need to reach out and touch others because that's ministry too. Ministry is not just left to ministers as we've identified them, but you too are a minister of the gospel, and we need you to carry out your charge in the kingdom by reaching out to others. So we encourage you to do that. All right. Today we are going to look at the gospel according to John chapter 5. The Gospel according to John, chapter 5. I want you to go there with me right now. I'm going to read to you for context purposes, not going to go verse by verse, but just for context, verses 1 through 9. The Gospel according to John, 5, 1 through 9. Is this advancing? Can you tell? Mm-hmm. It is. Okay. All right, I'm going to start reading at verse 1. After this, there was a feast of the Jews. This is King James Version. And Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there is at Jerusalem by the sheep market a pool, which is called in the Hebrew tongue Bethesda, having 5 porches. In these lay a great multitude of impotent folk, of blind, halt, withered, waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel went down at a certain season into the pool and troubled the water. Whosoever then first after the troubling of the water stepped in was made whole of whatsoever disease he had. And a certain man was there, which had an infirmity 38 years. When Jesus saw him lie and knew that he had been now a long time in that case, he saith unto him, Wilt thou be made whole? The impotent man answered him, Sir, I have no man when the water is troubled to put me into the pool. But while I am coming, another steppeth down before me. And Jesus saith unto him, Rise, take up thy bed, and walk. Verse 9, And immediately the man was made whole, and took up his bed, and walketh, and on the same day was the Sabbath. And then verse 10 goes on to say how the Jews took issue with him taking up his bed. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for your loving kindness toward us today. This is a day that you have made. We are going to rejoice and be glad in it. We suspend for the next few moments any of our concerns about the world around us. And we focus on your word as it comes forth. We pray it comes forth with power and with clarity, God, that it touches our lives, that it answers questions that we might have, gives us solutions that have eluded us thus far, solves a problem, helps us make a wiser decision. We know, God, that there is life in the spirit of your word. And so we pray that we might be partakers of that life, Lord. And as this seed gets sown, let it fall fresh and on good soil in us. In Christ's name, we pray for these things. Amen. All right. We have titled the sermon, 38 Years a Slave. 38 Years a Slave. If you all are familiar with the account, or maybe you know of it from the movie, 12 Years a Slave, of Solomon Northrop. 1841, Solomon Northrop, looking for work as a violinist, came upon two would-be con men who promised him work playing his violin in a circus. Well, it was all a ruse to capture him. Solomon Northrop was the son of a free man, and he lived in the free North. These men were capturing free blacks and selling them into slavery down south, and that's what happened to Solomon Northrop. And he would spend the next 12 years in slavery until he was found by friends and family and eventually free. 12 Years a Slave, the name of his story. I'm calling the sermon 38 Years a Slave because here we have the account of a man who lay by this pool of Bethesda, this sheep gate pool, if you will, for a long time. We don't know how long he had been there, but Christ had learned that however long he had been there, it had been a long time. He had been sick, impotent, or unable to walk for 38 years. I want you to... That part matters. That part matters. The fact that he had gone through this for 38 years. That part matters. What I want to talk to you about today is the conversation that Jesus has with the man. And I want you to try to be sympathetic, maybe even empathetic, to feel this man's struggle. It is real easy for us to judge others whom we deem have fallen short. The Bible tells us that when we see our brothers and our sisters, when we see our loved ones overtaken with the fault, it says, ye which are spiritual, should seek to restore them, to uplift them, to get them back to a right place. And the end of that verse says that in doing so, you should consider yourself. I believe that part of the verse calls on our empathy and our sympathy. When we look at those who are struggling, rather than wag the finger and be accusatory and condemning, understand the nature of their struggle and find a place in your heart to sympathize and to empathize with them the way that Christ does. He has turned to this man on the strength of how long he had struggled. There are other people lying by that same pool, waiting for that same troubling of the waters so that they too might be healed. But this man becomes a standout on the strength of how long he had suffered his affliction. Christ takes note of that. We should take note of that as we look at this conversation. The scripture says that Jesus approaches him, and the question that he asks him is, do you want to be made whole? Or would you like to be healed? Think about the question. Would you like to be healed? Now, at first blush, I would say it's sort of an empty question. I have been afflicted, lame, in the words of some verses, unable to walk for 4 decades. It should stand as an assumption that I'd like to have my legs back. But there is a deeper probe embedded in this question. There's actually a reason why Christ asked the question. God has this way. Remember, Christ is the fullness of the Godhead bodily, God in flesh. God had this habit throughout time, throughout scripture, of asking provocative questions. He wasn't asking to inform himself. God is omniscient, knows all things. The questions were meant to make us think. By us, the receiver of the question at the time that it was asked in scripture, but also those of us who would come upon those narratives and learn something from others. The questions are asked to provoke thought. And so when the question is asked by Christ, do you want to be healed? Do you want to be made whole? It does cause the man to think. It does cause the man to think. And it's that thought process that leads him to the response that he offers, which is that he says that, sir, I have no man when the water is troubled to put me into the pool. But while I am coming, another steppeth down before me. Verse 7, another steppeth down before me. So the answer wasn't, yes, I want to be healed, or no, I'm good where I am. The response comes in the form of an explanation of his current circumstances. Man, this is why I am where I am today. Please understand my situation. I've been laying here, sitting here a long time, and I've watched person after person go into those waters, unable to get there in time to be blessed by the miracle. Remember, the first person in the water gets the healing, gets the blessing. Apparently, he's too far from the water. So, because the questions are asked to provoke thought, I start thinking, right? Like, okay, what are some of the reasons this man, instead of answering the question directly, launches into an explanation or an excuse, if you will, for his current condition? What would make a person answer the way he answers? Better yet, why might I give that same answer to Jesus if I were in that situation? What is it that I would be thinking that would cause me not to give a straight yes, an anticipatory yes, bless me today, make me whole today, yes, I want to be made healed, let's make this happen? Why wouldn't I answer like that? Well, I come up with 3 reasons why I might answer the way the man answers. I'm going to give them to you real quickly, okay? Then we'll be done. The first reason has to do with filtered hearing. Filtered hearing, the way we hear. The second would be having a choice between the familiar present and an unfamiliar future. The familiar present and an unfamiliar future. So the first one is, I have filtered hearing. I'm not hearing right. The second is, I'm facing a choice between a familiar present and an unfamiliar future. The messages that I've preached before lead us to this point. Weeks ago when I preached about fear leads us to this point. Last week when I talked to you about the conversation that Jesus has with Peter about who he is and who others say he is. And remember what Jesus tells Peter, that he's going to grant to the church the power to loose and to bind, a power that will be honored in heaven, leads us to this moment, all right? So we have filtered hearing. We have to choose between the familiar present and the unfamiliar future. And then thirdly, we just lose a tolerance for any further disappointment in our lives. I cannot take any more disappointment. And somebody right now listening to me completely identifies with that third one. So many folks have let you down so many times, you're just not able to readily trust anybody anymore. Amen, somebody. So let me talk to you about the first one, the filtered hearing. What does that mean? It means our expectations can be a barrier to our comprehension of the Lord's presence and his powers. I'll say that again. Our expectations can be a barrier to us being able to understand the Lord's presence and his power. What do I mean by that? Studies have shown consistently over decades that humans struggle with hearing because we struggle with listening. Hearing is passive. Listening is active. Hearing is what you do even when you're not trying to do it. Right now, I hear noises all around me. I hear the fan of a computer. In the far, far distance, I hear a car passing by. I hear those things. I'm not listening for them. If my wife, who was sitting right in front of me, were to speak to me right now, I would listen to what she was saying because I would expect that it's going to be important. Hearing is passive. Listening is active. What do we mean by filtered hearing? Studies consistently show that as humans, when someone's talking to us, we only truly listen consistently from 17% to about 30% of what people are saying. We infer meaning. In fact, we read the same way. We don't often read word for word. We read line by line, and we get context out of key words. We don't pay attention to the details. And the information that we do take in allows us to draw a bigger picture, which is why sometimes when people say things, we misinterpret what they're saying because we don't decode correctly. Have you ever answered someone only to have them say, I'm sorry, that wasn't the question I was asking? Now, polite people will make it sound like they didn't ask the question clearly, when in fact the reality is the question was asked clearly, we weren't listening. Why do we filter what is said to us? One of the reasons shown in science is because we have the habit of thinking about a response before the words are fully out of the other party's mouth. While others are talking, we are already formulating what we're going to say. And despite how intelligent we think we are, you actually can't do both things effectively. You can't come up with an appropriate response and actively listen to a person at the same time. Something's going to come up short. More often than not, both things are going to come up short. That is, your response is going to fall short of the mark, and you are going to miss some key things that they are saying. We filter our hearing. Now, how do we filter our hearing? We formulate expectation of what's going to be said even before it is said. if I am the man in this situation, Jesus is likely not the first person who has talked to me about why I got there. And I have told this story before. In fact, I've told it over and over and over again. And here comes just another guy asking me why I've been here so long. He's just another guy. There is nothing in this narrative that suggests to me that this man is predisposed to having faith in Jesus as the Christ, the Messiah, the chosen one, the Son of God. There's nothing in this narrative that tells me he acknowledges or recognizes him as such. He's just another man asking me about my story. And I've told this story so many times that now I tell it the same way every time. I tell it the same way every time. And because I have this expectation, as soon as he approaches me about the transaction, I launch into doing what I've done before, which is just telling my story. But Christ isn't asking me to tell my story. He knows my story, which is why he came to me in the first place. What he's asking me is, do you want to be healed? But my filtered hearing doesn't have me answer that question, because I have these pre-formulated expectations of how people approach me, and he's just one of those people. Christ is just another one of those people. Filtered hearing becomes a barrier because it prevents us from acknowledging who Jesus truly is, what his presence truly means, what his power can truly do. Do we do that with Christ in our lives, particularly when it comes to our chronic struggles, the things that we've been going through a long time? Do we find it easier to trust God for the immediate short-term problems rather than for the long-standing chronic problems? Do we have an expectation that as we've been, we will always be? And so when we hear sermons and Bible lessons and the counsel and the wisdom of godly friends, do we filter what is being preached, taught, shared with us through this pre-formulated expectation that this is just another transaction, just another conversation, just another sermon, just another Bible lesson, and that there isn't direct impact upon my life? Filtered hearing. Filtered by our pre-formulated expectations. We got to be careful, because there is a fresh presence of God available for us every day. There is a fresh presence of God available for us every day. There is every reason to believe that God's going to do something today in our lives that he's never done before, because he can. But if we constrain him to what little we know of him based on the few experiences we've had in the past, then sometimes when he shows up to do something new, the new thing doesn't get done because we don't allow it to get done, because we don't approach in faith. Filtered hearing. Second reason, we have to choose between the familiar present and an unfamiliar future. You know, we have this device as humans, we have this thing that we can do when we're not ready to answer a question directly. And the thing that we do is we ramble on. We rant. Instead of directly addressing a question or an issue, we just talk randomly, trying to fill the time and the space with empty words. And perhaps that's what this man is doing. Being asked, are you willing to be made whole? He's now faced with the choice. If you had the choice between lying here at this pool for another 38 years, right? Or however much time, and actually being able to get up from here and walk and live a different life, would you choose to live that different life? There's a choice now between the familiar present and the unfamiliar future, because if I have been without the ability to walk for 38 years, that's the life I know. I've accommodated that life. I've figured out a scheme. Listen, you're not lame for 38 years without having some way to be fed every day. There's been some bathing. There's been some socializing. You have built a life around your lameness. You have built a life around your lameness, and that's the life you've known for 4 decades. And the question comes to mind, would I know how to live if I were whole? That's a different kind of life. I'm not even sure I'm capable of that kind of life. Because now if I have to walk, I have to work. Yeah, no excuses. If I can walk, people won't expect me to work. Do I have a saleable skill? How am I can survive off of alms right now, the charitable giving of others. But if I have to work, what am I gonna do? I don't have a skill. My skill is lying by this pool. That's what I know. And it's oftentimes what we don't know that keeps us a slave. When black people were emancipated and the word got around that you no longer have to work Massa's plantation, you can go live the life of a free person. Many of the plantation owners gave their slaves an option, right? I'll give you a parcel of land, you work my land, I'll give you a small plot of land of your own that you can work and you can live on that. And many that were legally free were not practically free, because many of those plantation owners still treated them like slaves. And they didn't leave those situations because they knew how to work their masters. They knew their personalities, they knew what set them off, and they felt like they could manage that relationship well enough to get by. And so they took those deals. I do not judge those people, just as I do not judge this man. I completely get it. Once you learn how to work your familiar, sometimes that becomes preferable to the unknown challenges of a future situation. I know how to do this. I know how to be lame. I know how to live like this. I don't know how to live in this unfamiliar future. I don't know what new challenges that's going to present. So I'm not sure. I'm not sure I know how to answer this question, Jesus. I'm not sure how to answer this question. Because if you're about to make my life radically different, I'm not sure I'm up to that particular challenge. And let's be honest, there comes a point in our lives where the chronic problem is how we define our lives. I am this thing that besets me. I am this chronic illness. I am this chronic problem. I identify with this, right? Everybody knows me by this. I'm okay. I've built my life around this. I can do this. I don't want the struggle of forming a new kind of life. Even though it might be better in quality, it's unfamiliar. It's going to put a demand on me that I'm not sure I'm up to. So I'm good where I am. I'm good where I am. I'm good in this affliction. I'm good in this addiction. I can handle it. I can handle it. How many of us look at our chronic problems, our chronic struggles, our chronic challenges and say, you know what? I can handle it. It's cool. It's good. I'm not going to even ask God for anything in this area. Clearly, this is the life that I've been led to. This is the life I'm supposed to live. So, hey, I'll deal with it. Won't pray about it. Won't trust God about it. Just going to live like this. I'm just going to live with my children, my spouse, my loved one addicted. I'm going to figure out how to make all this work. I'm going to live addicted. I'm going to figure out how to make all this work. I'm going to live my life sick. I'm going to figure out how to make all this work. I'm going to live my life depressed, fearful. I'm going to figure out how to make all this work. And all the time, Jesus is standing there saying, I have come to make you free. Do you want to be free? Well, see, Lord, it's like this. What had happened was, so I understand the filtered hearing. I understand the struggles we make choosing between a familiar present and an unfamiliar future. And I understand why some people choose the familiar present, even though it's problematic, even though you're struggling, even though it's causing you hardship and heartache and pain, and you're living in fear, frustration, anxiety, you're living with bitterness and anger, but it's the life you know, so it's the life you choose. But Jesus said, I am come that you might have true life and have it more abundantly. Amen. Are you willing to live that abundant life? Get it. Number three. Sometimes it's the filtered hearing. I don't hear what the Lord is saying because I have all of these expectations of always being what I've always been. The second one was, I don't want to choose the unfamiliar future because I'm comfortable enough in the familiar present. And then the third one is, we lose a tolerance for further disappointment. Listen to what the man says. He says, every time the water is troubled, right? Verse 7. He says, when the water's troubled, I have no man to put me into the pool. But I ain't got nobody. Every time this water gets troubled, I look around, I try to get people around me to help me. Nobody helps me. Perhaps some folks have said they'll come and help. They never showed up. People aren't my thing anymore. I can't trust people. And when I look at you, Jesus, I just see another person. I just see another person. Another person coming with big promises about what they'll do for me. Just another person who's going to let me down. And I'm not trying to trust nobody, including the Lord. Now, some of you listening today may say, who thinks that way? A lot of us think that way. And if you're honest with yourself, there have been times when you've thought that way. Lord, I want this so much that I'm afraid to pray about it. I'm afraid to pray about it because you may not give it to me, because it may not be realized, because it may not materialize, and I feel more comfortable just forgetting about it. I'm gonna avoid hope because when hope doesn't result in a realization of what I hope for, it's too painful. It's too painful, day after day, week after week, year after year. It's too painful to hope that I can get in that water. And I can't do it by myself, and I don't have anybody to help me. How many of you out there feel like, I don't have anybody to help me? I gotta do this, whatever this is, by myself. And the Lord's standing there, His presence, His power is in your life to transform your life, to heal you, to make you whole, to remedy your situation. He's offering you that deliverance. And yet, time after time, we reject receiving it because we are afraid to hope. God oftentimes works through people. You know, there was another paralytic in Scripture, and the Bible talks about Christ ministering in a home. And the home was full. And so four friends show up with their paralytic friend, but they can't get into the house to get to Jesus. So they devise this plan to crawl up on the roof and to lower their friend down right in front of Christ. That man had four friends to help him. And some of us feel like we don't have one friend to help us. And I think Christ wants me to tell you today that there are friends to help you, but your trust isn't going to be in the friends. Your trust must first have to be in Him. The Lord wants you to know that if you trust in Him, He'll send others your way to help you, but you have to trust Him. Stop putting your trust in yourself. Stop putting your trust in others. Help, trust Him. Have faith in Christ. He will conscript others to come into your life, to bless your life, and to help you to a better place. But your faith is at issue right now. Your faith in Christ is at issue. It is impossible to please the Lord without faith. And without faith, you shouldn't expect anything of Him. But with faith, all things are possible. For this is the victory that overcometh the world, our faith. You can be a victor by faith. You can overcome by faith. You can be healed by faith. You can be made whole by faith. You can be delivered from your addictions and your afflictions by faith. But you're going to have to trust the Lord. Finally, this. Despite himself, the Lord healed him. And in the Gospels, we would be told about this narrative, that the Lord did that so that it might be clear that Jesus the man had authority even here on earth. Let me say this to you believers. God does amazing things through us. Through us, so that his power might be manifest in us. Men see our good works and then glorify our Father which is in heaven. Christ wanted to show that he had the power to loose and to bind, the power to deliver and to restore. And sometimes he acts even in the absence of our faith, but that cannot be our expectation. This man was blessed despite himself. But you can invite a purposeful blessing in your life by demonstrating faith in Christ. Take hold of that thing right now that is on your life. That thing that you have been struggling with for a very long time. That thing about which you are losing hope right now. And dare to trust Jesus to make a change in your life. The scripture says your very faith is victory. Are you able? Are you willing to be made whole? Do you want to be healed? Do you want to be fixed? Or have you found a comfortable life in the midst of your affliction? Because if you have resigned yourself to live that way, most likely you will have to live that way for the rest of your life. Trust God, trust the Lord to make the difference in your life. 38 years a slave, slave to the pain, slave to the affliction. How long have you been a slave to your pain? Servicing it, surrendering to it, building a life around it. The Lord wants you to know that you can trust him today to make the difference in your life, to deliver, to restore, to loose, to bind. Father, we thank you for your loving kindness toward us and for your power as it is manifest in our lives. Lord, we call upon you now to see where we are, to see where we struggle. God, give us strength. Give us strength. Help our faith to increase. Help us to be people of hope. We have been transformed by your blood and by your love, Jesus. Help us to live by the power of that transformation. Lord, we thank you today. And we call the undone things done. We believe by faith that you are healing us, that you are delivering us from our addictions, that you are giving us answers for our problems, that you are giving us wisdom for those difficult decisions that we have to make. And we thank you prospectively, God. By faith, we lay hold to our deliverance, to our restoration, to our healing, to our wholeness. In Jesus' name, no weapon formed against us shall prosper. In Jesus' name, all of our needs are supplied. In Jesus' name, Lord, you are with us, for you shall never forsake us. And we thank you for these victories. Amen. Amen. We are praying for you. We are praying with you. Whatever you need, God has it. Trust him. Until next week, thank you for joining us for this edition of Sunday Live with Bethel Church. God bless you.